Hello everyone. Hope your interview preparations are going good. To enhance your preparation, Smart Leaders has given interview questions and Tamil Nadu related interview questions and also sociology related interview questions to have a wide scope on these areas. So you can download these interview questions given below in the description box. So for today, we are going to see the news analysis dated 9th January 2019. So today, these are the six articles we are going to do for the today's prelims analysis. So the first one is related to the places in news, which is Norway and Turkey, because the Norwegian Prime Minister has visited India. And the second news item is related to the Supreme Court's ruling on Monsanto's patent claim on its BT cotton seed. And the third item is about the 10% reservation in jobs and educational institutions is passed in Lok Sabha yesterday. And the next item is about the DNA technology bill, which was passed in the Lok Sabha recently. And next one is about the 5-member RBI panel on digital payments. And the last one is about the year-end review of the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. The first article we are going to see for today's analysis is places in news, which is Norway. This Norway is in news because Norwegian Prime Minister and our Indian Prime Minister has met yesterday. And this Norway is a Scandinavian country and it is located on the northwest end of the Scandinavian part. This Norway is surrounded by Arctic Ocean in the north, and in the left hand side, which is the western side, it is surrounded by the Norwegian Sea, and the southern side it is bound by the North Sea. You have to see the geography of the Scandinavian mountain extends from the south of the Norway towards the northern side of the Norway. Here the capital of Norway is Oslo. Here we have to note that in 1993 an Oslo Accord was signed between Palestine and Israel. Through this accord, Palestine and Israel came with a consensus to maintain peace relations between these two nations. Through this Oslo Accord of 1993, a Palestinian authority has been established, which will regulate the West Bank and Gaza Strip, which is present over the Israel mainland. So these two, West Bank and Gaza Strip, is belong to neither of the countries. So another important feature of this Norway is the country's longest river Glomma flourishes through the mainland of Norway. And in the eastern side, it is bounded by the country of Sweden, and which of east is present the Gulf of Bothnia. This separates the Sweden and Finland. And one more thing to be noted is that in the north region of the Norway, there is a place called Svalbard, where the world's seed vault is present, in which globally significant and very important seed varieties are stored and maintained. And in the southwestern part, there is an Hardanger Fjord. So here we have to see what is this geographical feature of Fjord. Fjord is nothing but a narrow sea with a very sliding landmass. So if the landmass is here, the sea will be very narrow and the side bounded by the sea is very slopy. So if the narrow sea is bounded by three sides, very steep slopes of the land, it will be referred as a fjord. So this geographical feature has some economic potential also, which the country is utilizing. Apart from this, Norway is a highly developed nation with its human capital very strong, and it stood first in the inequality adjusted human development index. Apart from this, it also stands first in the happiness report, democracy report, etc. So this place becomes very important for the prelims point of view. So the next place for our analysis is about Turkey. So why this Turkey is in news? Because there is a hydroelectric dam project called Ilisu. This hydroelectric dam project is going to be constructed on the river Tigris, which is flowing on the Turkey, which is mainly on the eastern part. So in this place, this hydroelectric dam project is going to be established. Upon establishment of this Ilisu hydroelectric dam project, a town nearby called Hasankeyf. This Hasankeyf in the northern, little northern part of this proposed project is going to be swallowed up. What is significant about this Hasankeyf town? This is the oldest town in Turkey, which is suspected to be 12,000 years old. So if we are going to build this Ilisu hydroelectric dam project, One of the important heritage site of Turkey, which is this town Hasankeyf, will get swallowed. So based on this news item, we shall see the geography of Turkey. So Turkey is one of the Eurasian country after Russia, which extends both in Europe as well as in Asia. It is separated from the Europe by a small strait called Bosphorus Strait. So this Bosphorus Strait is connecting between Sea of Marmara in the left hand side and the right hand side with the Black Sea. This Bosphorus Strait was also recently in use because of its water turning wild blue in color. So this becomes an important point. Apart from this, in the mainland of the Asian Turkey, the Anatolian Plateau, which is very famous for its resources, is also stretching from the northwestern to southeast region. Because of this Anatolian Plateau, Turkey was also called as the Anatolia, especially in the Asian part of the Turkey. Bounded with this Anatolian Plateau, there present a Taurus Mountains, which stretches from the west towards east. So this is the longest mountain in the Turkey. The highest peak in this Taurus Mountain is Mount Ararat, which is ranging about 60,000 feet from that of the mean sea level. And as I have said that river Tigris flows through this Turkey's Asian part, it is very important to know that the Lake Van is also situated besides this river Tigris. So this Lake Van is one of the saltwater lake in the world. It stands second after the Dead Sea based on its high salinity content. And the capital of Turkey is Ankara. So the countries bounding this Turkey are Georgia, Armenia, Iran, and some part of Iraq and Syria. In the northern side, in the Europe part of the Turkey, there is also present one more strait called the Dardanelles Strait. So this Dardanelles Strait is connecting the Aegean Sea of the Western Europe with the Sea of Marmara between the European part of Turkey as well as the Asian part of Turkey. So these are some of the geographical facts about the Turkey which should be noted for the prelims perspective. So the next news item we are going to see is about the Supreme Court's ruling on the Monsanto's patent claim on its BT cotton seed. So this article has been taken from Hindu and it also appeared in the paper Mint. So here, before the recent news regarding the Supreme Court ruling, we have to see the background of its Monsanto's BT cotton seed. As we all know that the Indian variety of cotton crop is producing very low yield. And apart from this, it was attacked by a pest called the pink bollworm cotton disease. So in order to curb this pest disease among the cotton plants of the Indian variety, the Monsanto company, which is a US company, has brought with a BT cotton seed. So this BT cotton seed variety is resistant to this pink bollworm cotton disease and it produces high yield. So this Monsanto company has experimented its BT cotton seed in the Indian soil and it worked successful in the initial stages. But after a while it was attacked by the another pest disease called as the white bollworm cotton pest disease. So in order to tackle this new pest disease in its own BT cotton seed, the Monsanto company has brought up with the new pesticide. But the Indian farmers have suffered a lot because of the monopolizing nature present with the Monsanto's pesticide. Because of this reason, that was a debt trap with these Indian cotton cultivators. Following this, the Monsanto company has acquired patent rights from the government of India for this BT cotton variety to be planted in the Indian soil. After a while, this patent of its BT cotton variety has been transformed to another company called Nusi Vidu Limited. So this process of transforming of one licensee to the other licensee is called as the sub-license mechanism. So because of this sub-license agreement between the Monsanto and Nusi Vidu, the Nusi Vidu company will be distributing the BT cotton seeds manufactured by the Monsanto company. Through this transformation of patent rights from Monsanto to the Nusi Vidu, the Monsanto company shall claim royalty from the Nusi Vidu for its own BT cotton variety. But this Nusi Vidu company has profiled a suit in Delhi High Court, stating that as the license agreement has terminated, the Monsanto company is not supposed to levy the royalty from the Nusivedu. So this claim was analyzed by the Delhi High Court. So based on this, Delhi High Court in 2015 has given a verdict that plant varieties and seeds cannot be patented under the Indian law by the companies. So based on this, the Monsanto's patent claim on its BT cotton has been terminated. And apart from this, the royalties on the GM technology should be decided by a specialized agency kept under the Ministry of Agriculture. This verdict is against the Monsanto's patent claim as well as the royalty claim from the Nusivedu company. Based on this, the Monsanto company has appealed this judgment of the Delhi High Court on the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has recently reversed the Delhi High Court order and has restored its patent claim on its genetically modified BT cotton until its validity is decided by a single judge of the Delhi High Court. So with this judgment, the Monsanto company can claim its patent rights over its BT cotton as well as can levy the royalty as prescribed by the single judge of the Delhi High Court. So based on this verdict, the patent held by the Monsanto can be enforceable in India for now. So as I said that the Supreme Court has reversed the earliest Delhi High Court judgment based on that IPR, which is the intellectual property rights, whether it shall be a global IPR or Indian IPR, needs protection. And this verdict of Delhi High Court is a shot in the arm for India's agri-biotechnic industry that has been looking to improve the Indian cotton farmers' competitiveness. So only when the patent rights are protected, the competitiveness shall be ensured and thereby the cultivators shall also be benefited. But this Delhi High Court judgment is violative of this common protection rights of the IPR holder. Apart from that, the Supreme Court has also objected the Delhi High Court's interpretation of the Section 3J of the Patents Act of 1970. So what is this Patents Act of 1970 in its 3J saying is that? So the Section 3J of this Patents Act of 1970 says that whether the patent rights has been given based on a firm evidence for the patent applicant. So this is under the jurisdiction of the approval committee. So this Section 3J is very vague in its nature, and this was claimed by the Delhi High Court on its verdict of dismissing the patent rights of the Monsanto. So this could prove to be an impediment for the entry of the new technology in the Indian agriculture sector. And also it will lose the pricing freedom of the developers. So these issues are stated by the Supreme Court, and based on this, the Supreme Court has awarded a verdict supporting the Monsanto's patent claim. So the next article for our analysis is about the 10% reservation for poor, which has been approved by the cabinet recently, has been passed in the Lok Sabha. So this article has been taken from Hindu. As we all know that the Article 15 Clause 4 and 16 Clause 4 of the Indian Constitution states reservation based on only social and educational backwardness for educational institutions and in employments. This cabinet approved reservation based on the economic criteria has been passed in Lok Sabha with majority. So this is a constitutional amendment bill, and which is 124th constitutional amendment bill of the 2019. So the economically weaker sections who are eligible for this 10% reservation of this bill should stand under these criterias. First is one, they should have an 8 lakh per annum of annual income and should have a less than of 5 acres of the agricultural land, having a house smaller than 1000 square feet and have a residential plot smaller than 100 yards in a municipality, and apart from this, a residential plot of less than 200 yards in a non-notified municipality. Only when satisfying these criterias, one could claim the 10% reservation under this economically weaker section reservation in the employments and educational institutions. So here we have to see what is the provisions mentioned in the constitution for passing this constitutional amendment bill. So it should be passed with a special majority. So here special majority accounts to 50% of the total membership present in both the houses, and plus it should be passed by the 2/3 present plus voting. Also it should be ratified by half of the state legislatures. Only when satisfying these criteria, the bill stands passed in both the houses. As of now, the bill has been passed in Lok Sabha, but Rajya Sabha it is yet to be passed. But even if Rajya Sabha passes, this bill should stand the test of the judicial scrutiny. As we all know that the Indira Sani case of 1992 has capped the quotas at 50% of the available seats. This 10% reservation based on the economic criteria is violative of the Indira Sani case judgment. Based on this, the Supreme Court can deny this bill. Otherwise, if it agrees to enforce this bill, the Supreme Court has to remove the 50% cap as proposed in the Indira Sani case and should be made available for the 10% reservation based on the economic criteria. So based on this, all states of India can extend the quantum of reservation and the upper caste will stand to lose in the state services. But if it rejects, the economically weaker section quota shall be provided only by eating upon the reservation given for the SC, ST and OBC quota pie. So which will have the social and political implications. So we have to wait what the Rajya Sabha or the Supreme Court is going to award for making this bill enforced. So the next article for our analysis is about the DNA technology bill which is passed by the Lok Sabha. So what is this DNA technology bill? This DNA technology bill has allowed to have a regulated use of the DNA technology to establish the identity of certain defined categories of persons like offenders, suspects and under trials. So allowing this bill to become an act will empower the criminal justice delivery system by enabling the application of the DNA evidence. Apart from this, this bill will also allow the use of the DNA technology to establish the identity of the persons in matters of parentage dispute, immigration and transplantation of the human organs. So in order to enforce this bill, there will be establishment of national and regional DNA data banks. So this data related to the DNA will be stored in this national and regional data banks. And it will propose the indices for the criminal justice system or other disputes like that of the parentage dispute or immigration. So each data will be maintained the indices including the crime scene index, suspects or under trials index and offenders index. So based on these indices will provide data in order to improve the efficiency of the criminal justice system. So one concern related to this bill is it has a potential misuse of the DNA samples and blood samples collected by the clinical laboratory. So it poses a question on the individual's privacy. So the next article is about that an RBI panel which is comprising of 5 members under the leadership of former UIDAI chief Nandan Nilekani in order to improve the digital payments. So this article has been taken from the Hindu. In order to improvise the digital payments, RBI has constituted many such committees like Ratan Watal Committee. So this committee will review the existing status of digitization of payments in the country. As we all know that the digital payments are increasing widely and the e-commerce industry is also widening. It is essential to regulate and improvise this digital payment sector. So this committee will also identify the current gaps in the ecosystem and suggest some measures to bridge the gap and harness the potential present in this digital payment sector. It would also assess the current levels of the digital payment and will provide some measures to have the financial inclusion. And it will also increase the customer confidence to use the digital transactions and would suggest a medium-term strategy for the deepening of the digital payments. So for the prelims perspective, that is only one point should be noted that this Nandan Nilekani committee is related to this digital payment regulation and improvisation. So the last article for our analysis is about the year-end review of the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. In this, we are going to see the new urea policy of 2015. So prior to this new area policy of 2015, there was a flaw present in the system. In the name of agriculture purposes, subsidized urea from the urea manufacturing industries was hoarded and diverted for other industrial purposes like explosive industry. So this becomes a concern, and there arises a need to regulate this urea industry. Based on this, this new urea policy was proposed by the government. So through this new urea policy, the urea for the agricultural purposes will be specially coated with the neem. So this neem coated urea shall only be used in the agricultural fields, and this coated urea shall have a slow release of nutrients into the soil. So with this slow release of the nutrients from this neem coated urea, the soil pollution and water pollution arising out of the fertilization shall be curbed. And also to maximize the indigenous urea production, this new urea policy is having some platform to enhance the industrial urea production. And to promote the energy efficiency in the urea units and to rationalize the subsidy burden on the government of India, this new urea policy has proposed some measures. So this is one of the initiative of Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers in the year of 2018. Apart from this, the Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana is also implemented by the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. So through this Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana, Jan Aushadhis will be established in each districts in order to deliver generic medicines at a low cost. Upon implementation of this scheme, it will have a high quality medicines available at affordable prices for all. And mainly the poor and the disadvantaged are the beneficiaries through this affordable pricing of the generic medicines. So these Jan Aushadhi Kendras, to reduce the out-of-pocket expenditures in the healthcare, so upon proper implementation of this scheme, it would have an inclusive access to the healthcare services and to accomplish the sustainable development goals of India.